Da-dum, da-dum. Hey. Through summer's long and winter's cold, may you always have someone good to hold. And may good fortune be a loyal friend. And may your winning streak, may it never end. So roll the dice, boy, 'cause my money's on you. And take my advice now and put your money down too. Because there's something in the eye you just can't pretend. And may your winning streak, may it never end. And may the sign of the Southern Cross be some comfort to you when you're lost. And may the devil's evil eye pass you by. Well, it's not for glory, I tell you true, that I do these things that I do for you. For a promise I made, now I must pretend. And may your winning streak, may it never end. Of good brethren, turn you around. And may the devil's evil eye pass you right by. Don't you look back, my friend. And may the sisters of good charity take you in. Through summer's long and winter's cold, may you always have someone good to hold. And may good fortune be a constant and a loyal friend. And may your winning streak, may it never end. May your winning streak, may it never end. May your winning streak, may it never end. Hey everybody, welcome back to my kitchen and a few questions with a friend. That song is a song called Winning Streak, and it's from a record of mine called Rhythm and Repose, which is an album I made in New York around 2010. I was living there and made that record. And when it came time to put the record out, I asked a wonderful artist from Belfast here in Ireland, would he mind if I used a painting he had made of me? I met Colin Davidson right after I saw a painting of Duke Special. Wonderful Belfast artist, an incredible painting of Duke Special. I saw it, somebody posted it somewhere, and I'd made some comment on it. And I remember receiving a message from Colin asking, would I be interested in sitting for a portrait? And I was hugely honored. I remember I had just gotten back from America, and I he came down to the house and we spent some hours. So I'm going to ask Colin a few questions tonight. We're going to just talk about art and talk about each other's art and let the conversation roll. And I notice that the more I prepare for these things, the harder it can be to do it. So I'm just going to get Colin on now. Let me see. I think he's probably there somewhere. Let me see. Colin, there's Colin now. If I add, let's see. Waiting for Colin. See if he pops in.
Hey, Glen.
Colin, how are you, brother?
How are you doing?
I'm great.
Great.
My goodness, me and you are from the same tribe. I mean, look at us.
Absolutely. I mean, it makes makes me think of the Europa Hotel in Belfast a few months ago, where we were sitting having a meal or a drink or something like that. I think the waitress came across and thought that we were brothers or twins or something like that.
Or thought I was your dad.
I think it's the other way around, Glenn.
I remember I did a few songs with Ed Sheeran at a concert of his. He played a gig in Dublin. He played three nights in the Croke Park. And I remember I was standing in the audience and I had the pass, VIP or whatever, because I was going to go sing with him. And someone, as I was making my way to the stage, somebody said, "There's Ed Sheeran's dad."
Could easily be, Glenn. Oh, boy. Yeah, I can see that. But definitely. So how's things? How's things been with you?
You know, it's been an incredible day today. You know, we've got to that point in the lockdown, in the kind of distancing where, I found myself out in a field today cutting my toenails with a Bowie knife. And you know that when you're doing that, you've spent too long on your own.
My daughter got sent some gel nails,
yeah,
which were about this length, right?
Yeah.
And I said to her, "Sure, go on out the back and I'll get the chainsaw. And if you hold your hands very still, I'll cut them down." So you do suggest very strange things.
Yeah, I've been, we've got these lovely neighbours, the Doran brothers, and they're very, very sweet. You've met them. You've met the Dorans.
I have. Yeah, I have.
And, you know, I really think Felix Doran should have his own chat show. He just has such a wonderful temperament. With anyone he meets, he just begins to ask them questions. And I'd love to film it each time. But he and Tom brought Myra. They found an old... That's Kez. She's in the window now.
Hey, Kez.
Barking at something in the garden. Oh, she's gone. He brought Myra, fair play to him, he found an old 70s rally in a skip. And he brought it here. And so I've been slowly restoring it. Each day, just tipping away, getting the rust off, really enjoying the days are just blurring into each other. That's what is buzzword.
I find that completely. I mean, one thing I find interesting that you said at the very start of this was that you weren't in the right creative place. You weren't in the right place to write or to make music. You kind of needed to settle into this new environment in which we found ourselves. And then next time I heard you speak, or next time I spoke to you, it seemed like quite a quick sort of a transition into being in the creative space. Am I right?
You are, Colin. You are in that, because Colin, I had actually taken a year off anyway. I had planned to take this year off, and it's funnily enough, I was explaining this the last time I was on as well, that our nature is to stay busy. My nature is to stay busy, and so my year was getting busier and busier. There was some concerts coming up for Interference, and dear friend of mine Fergus O'Farrell, who fronted my childhood hero band here in Dublin. They were from Cork, a band called Interference, and I was going to be fronting Ferg unfortunately died a couple of years ago, and I was going to front some concerts to promote a movie that's been made about his life, a wonderful film called Breaking Out. And so we were going to be doing some concerts, which was a really exciting thing. But I noticed that my year was getting busier. That was going to be essentially a month. And then there was the Frames gigs. And the Frames, there was supposed to be initially one Frames gig, and then that Frames gig turned into maybe a few gigs in America. And then there was talk of maybe one or two other little things. And so my year was definitely getting busier. And what I found really, really interesting and compelling about this time off has been, all I wanted to do at the beginning of a column was just to listen. I just wanted to listen to what was going on in the world, not listen to the news, but that also, but not, just listen. There was something going on.
I got, without wanting to sound too esoteric, I would say something going on another level that I wanted to tune into. And so it meant that I wasn't writing songs, you know. And also, you know, I'm a big believer that, you know, we're talking last week with Mary Reynolds about gardening, and I'm a big believer in the idea that you have to allow the ground to go fallow every so often. And sometimes you actually have to plan that time. You have to take that time and put a flag in it and say, I'm actually not going to be creative. I'm going to be consciously uncreative for this period. And which is kind of where I found myself. Although, of course, it's ended up being a very creative time. Hello, everybody. I'm just noticing the messages coming in. Hello, everybody. So have you found something similar, Colin?
Yeah, I mean, I find at the start of lockdown, what was it, 8-9 weeks ago now, I found I just got into the studio and worked solidly for 4 weeks. And I nearly burnt myself out. Mm-hmm. My normal practice would be that I would be out, I would travel a fair bit for portraits and people would sit for me, and I wasn't able to do that. And so I was just in the studio, and I had a real creative 4 weeks, and I made a lot of work and really pushed some ideas on. But then I sort of felt I needed to get a break from it. And same as you, I mean, we're hugely thankful that we have a little bit of outside space. And I went and felled a tree that had died, and instead of getting somebody else in to do it, I just did it myself. Planted a sort of a wildflower bit, and I completely and utterly identified with what you were talking about, where you talk about the land and needing to reacquaint yourself as a human being with the land. And with that, and in some ways, Glen, where we came from, and in some ways, where we're going to, and I think we forget that. We forget that this stuff that we are playing with and manipulating it as we plant and as we furrow and as we dig, this is the very stuff that we are made from, and it brings you right back to that human. You know, in some ways, the bare bones of what being a human being is actually about. And I find that I go back, Glen, to, you know, ancient ancestors who, you know, even before agriculture, you know, they still worked the land. They still used the land. And that, and in some ways, that is very firmly in our DNA.
Yeah, yeah. And this land that we live on, this country of Ireland, you know, Ireland, and you know, it's an interesting time, because I find myself connecting with this place that I live in, this piece of land, just this little bit here, the garden, and I sort of feel like the garden is a microcosm for the whole world, you know, and we live on a. We live on a very fertile island, but the soil does get tired. And for instance, there's one spot for
What would you do without dogs, Glen?
Oh, she's wonderful. We
have a couple of dogs, and they're just the best thing.
But it's her house now. She's the queen of the house now. She's guarding.
That's the way it is. Window.
You know, I just sort of feel like there's a connection with the earth and with the soil, and that we've been planting potatoes in one particular patch over the last few years, and I just realized that you can't plant potatoes for more than 2 or 3 years, or actually you're not supposed to plant them 2 years in a row in the same spot. That you have to give the soil other information, and just I love the idea that the soil is a reflection of what's going on in us and what's going on, that we are the soil and soil is us, as you say. And I suppose, you know, there's been so much moving and so much unconnectedness. You know, I've been quite rootless for a long time. I move around a lot. And in a way, you feel like a seed in the wind, you know. But I've noticed that lately I'm beginning to put down some roots, and it's only when you get to that place where you're beginning to put down some roots that you have somewhere firm to sing from and somewhere stable to sing from. And so it's, I feel this time, whether I like it or not, is going to change my writing in a very different way. You know, I feel very very connected in here right now. And you know, people have been asking me how I've been getting on, you know, in the lockdown and stuff. I have to say that I'm absolutely loving it. Now, I know that there's an awful lot of tragedy and there's an awful lot of sadness, but I'm absolutely loving it. I'm finding this time to be, it's like, what is it that it would happen in the universe? You know, I kind of almost see it as Mother Nature going, okay, everybody stop, stay at home, turn off the TV was kind of is what we've been doing. We've turned off the TV and it's brilliant. I have to say, what a freedom to just turn it off. Turn off the TV, like stop flying, stop moving around. Put your feet in the ground, stay still. And there's an incredible opportunity for everybody right now to deepen. And last night I was doing the dishes and I was listening to BBC World Service. And there are people talking about, you know, how this is going to change economies. And of course, the economies are in a lot of trouble and a lot of people are in a lot of trouble. And you can feel that. There's a huge sense of that as well. But there's also a sense that, you know, the green agenda, if you like, if it is the green agenda, has been really, really pushed forward through this time. You know, we didn't need that many airlines. We didn't need that many flights. There's something really kind of wonderful happening. And it's almost happening. If nature has a consciousness, it's almost as if it's a shot across the bow.
Absolutely. Yeah. I agree completely. Just by the way, Glen, some people in the feed are saying that I'm really clear. And you're
Okay. Now, are you hit my camera?
Is everybody happy with that? Is
let me just
no, I think it's more the Wi-Fi connection maybe isn't fantastic at your end.
Is that any better?
Still a bit pixelated.
Okay. Is it possible? Yeah. Let me it could be my because I live in the countryside and it's pretty Our Wi-Fi is pretty bad.
I'm happy to keep going, Glen, if you are. I can see you completely, and in fact, you're clearing up from time to time, but sometimes it goes a little bit more blurry.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you what, let me check my connection. If I get cut off, let me check my connection. Is that any better? I don't think it is.
It's not, Glen. Listen, let's just leave it the way it is. Okay, we just got to go with
Sorry,
it. Apparently,
folks.
Everybody can hear us fine, so it's that's the main thing.
I could go off the internet and see if I can just do it on the phone. Let's see. I may have to go outside.
All right, 4G.
Yeah, I may have to just
an idea.
Let me see. Hopefully, I won't lose you. Right. Let me see. This might be nice. I can sit in the window. Okay. Let me see. No,
I met him first in.
Yep. Am I still there?
That's good.
Is it better?
Slightly. Yes. Let's go with that.
Let's continue from here.
Okay, Glen, what I was going to say to you, to get back to the question or the things that you were talking about before there.
Yeah.
I suppose, I agree completely in the sense that, and it factors into my art as well, and I suspect it factors into your art, mm-hmm. where actually I think that freedom in art needs boundaries of sorts put in place. And who would have believed somebody before this lockdown if they'd said to you, you're going to actually feel more free in yourself as a result of being locked in.
Yeah, right.
And so actually I think that we have this idea of freedom, an idea of freedom in art.
Yeah.
That it's all about chucking the laws out and chucking all the rules away.
Yeah.
But in some ways, I mean, I find with my own painting, and I don't know if you find it with your work, I find it very much, Glen, that I need those boundaries put in place. I need the canvas to be, yes, a certain size. I, yes, need it with the portraits in particular to have a particular drawing in place that I can have it as a framework in which to be free with the paint.
Yes.
So in some ways, the freedom in creativity needs the boundaries of sorts in place. Do you find that in your own work?
The absence of limitations, isn't that the?
There you are.
I found that with the technology around recording, that when you can keep on recording, you can keep on doing more takes and more takes and more takes. That actually, it does end up sort of getting in the way.
Yeah.
Of the creative process. Sorry, I'm just getting myself comfortable outside because I figure why not.
Oh, sure.
Absolutely. When there are limits, it almost, you're forced to rethink and you're forced to kind of think in a different direction. I find that, sometimes if you go away or you just sometimes, like if I just take a mandolin with me and nothing else,
yeah,
that I'm forced to just spend time with that one instrument, and each instrument, depending on its tone and its sound, will bring a whole certain set of ideas and tones to mind, and you'll sing to the instrument. It's almost like you compensate for the sound of the instrument to try, so you find yourself singing deeper if the instrument is higher.
Yeah, and you end up using the limitations of the subject. I'm talking about my own painting here, where, mm-hmm, I obviously, if I'm painting you or whoever I happen to be painting,
yeah,
I've obviously got the limitations self-imposed that I am painting the person who is sitting in front of me. But that then starts to inform a whole lot of other ideas and informs a whole lot of other directions which you can go in as well, which actually I find that I would be completely lost as a painter if I didn't have those. See them as sort of guides. I see the limitations as kind of guides. And that's what I mean, going right back to what you said there, the lockdown and the fact that all these limitations have been imposed, they can be guides for us. They can be inspiration for us.
Yeah.
And it's perfectly possible to be completely free within those, Glen, I think.
I really like what you're saying. Yeah. Yeah. I really enjoy that. There's the fact that we're kind of just here now, and there's a lovely book by Viktor Frankl, who was a Holocaust survivor, an incredible book. And it's all about surviving, about the kind of mental survival. And he talked about the only reason he was able to survive the death camps was knowing that he'd see his wife again one day. And that kept him alive. And so his whole book is about the book is called Man's Search for Meaning. Beautiful book. But he talks about, we must give this life meaning. We must give this suffering meaning. We must give this moment meaning. That's the way we survive, is by giving this moment and everything about it, giving it some meaning through creativity. And I'm a huge fan of his. I think he's an incredible. He's an incredible writer. This is lovely out here, actually.
It's beautiful, actually, Glen, and you are completely crystal clear. So it's all good. But, Glen, I'm interested because I'm going through this myself as well, where, I think sometimes in the middle of something, it can be hard to, as a creative, as an artist, figure out what your comment is, figure out what your role is.
Yeah.
It's sometimes after an event with retrospect that it's clear what you need to do. Are you finding at the minute in the creative period that you're going through now, are you finding that you are commenting at all on the situation in which you find yourself, or are you allowing yourself to escape that completely?
Both. Yes, it is a creaky chair, everybody. Yeah, both, Colin, because I tell you, I'm on the one hand, I've turned off the TV, and on the other hand, I'm listening to the muse, you know, and kind of a sort of staying open. Excuse me, everybody. I just painted the chair. That's why it's
just let it creak.
Yeah, I've been painting the chair, but it's I find that I've been I've written a couple of songs, and because it's impossible not to write about this right now, it's impossible to not to address it or not to speak of it somehow. So yeah, I've written a couple of songs. I wrote one song specifically, and I wrote a song and I put a video up last week. But it was almost like allowing the spirit to flow, and
we made it soaked, Glen.
With the one where I got soaked.
Yeah.
But what was lovely about that was that even in this lockdown, you can make it. You can record a song at home. You can throw it out. You can record it, do a quick mix of it, put it up for friends, make a quick video for it in your garden. And it just shows you that with no access to studios, not going on tour, you can still be hugely creative and still actually have a strong relationship with your audience, you know, with your patrons, because essentially that's, you know, I want to thank everybody for tuning in again tonight to this, because these are wonderful chats. It's a wonderful opportunity to stay connected, because I feel it too. I feel like I want connection. I want to reach out to all the people that I know, and, you know, in America and in Brazil and Spain and Italy and France. I want to reach out to them and say, are you okay? Mm-hmm. Because I have a huge sense of compassion at the moment. It's much more, I think normally I'd be quite sort of empathic, or, you know, I think part of what we do as artists is that we tune into the spirit of things and we speak to that. But I feel it more than ever now. I feel so much more, I feel a real sense of responsibility to connect. And so me and you talking, you know, we could have easily just had a phone call, but I love the idea that we have this phone call among friends, because there's something about, hey, is okay, you know, is everybody okay? Yeah. Are we all, how are we doing, you know?
And I think it's very important for everybody else as well, Glen, to see that you're fine. Yeah. And to see that I think as artists, we can sometimes fall into the trap of being, I'm talking about myself here, I'm not talking about you. I can sometimes fall into the trap of maybe being too precious about my own work, and sort of deliberately sort of thinking I'm being too accessible.
Yes.
But in actual fact, in this day and age, whenever everybody is tuning in to everybody else, and we're making art. I think art, I mean, I know that I make art in order that ultimately it will be completed by somebody else. You know, I think that any work of art, and I mean music or film or painting or photography or whatever, in the whole gamut of the arts, I think that the maker of the best work leaves an intangible gap in that work to be filled by the person who kind of engages. I mean, what's the point in a song not being sung? A song not being sung has no point.
But it's the saddest thing.
Yeah, but there's no point in it.
Yeah.
A painting that is not being looked at has no point. At that moment in time, it has no point.
Yeah.
So I actually think that what you're doing, particularly in, you know, that sort of that gig from your kitchen a few weeks ago, you know, you're leaving, you're broadcasting those gaps in amongst it all, and people are finding themselves within that. And I think mm-hmm. that is what you're making the music for. You're not making the music. I mean, some of us say, yes, you're making the music for yourself, and there's got to be a bit of that, yes. But in actual fact, it needs everybody else in order to complete it.
100%. What is a singer without an audience? What is a song without, you know, a song is written to be heard. It's a painting is done to be seen. And it's our way of making sense of our own lives. But it's also an act, a civic act. It's an act of standing and speaking to the people around you. I, you know, which actually brings me to it, because the reason I did the songwriting, which was actually, you know, I didn't prepare for that at all. I just kind of went on and I realized, and it's a funny thing, when I don't prepare for something, I always, it's the reason my gigs can be so long. When I'm not prepared and I get nervous, I go on and I go, and I overshare. And so in a way, it ended up being 2 hours. The songwriting thing, and in a way I only got to a tiny amount of what I hoped I'd speak about. But the thing that inspired me to do that songwriting, I guess, you know, I don't want to call it a talk, because it wasn't a talk, it wasn't a lecture, it certainly wasn't coming from the point of view of family, but it was you put up this thing on Instagram a few weeks ago where you just put out some green, red and blue, and you said white and black, and you said you can make every color from these primary colors. And watching your video, I just felt such an overwhelming sense of warmth and generosity, and I thought, that's something that you don't see, you know, that sort of sense of just people sort of saying, look, well, you know, here's what I do, you know. And if anyone wants to check that out, it's on Colin's page. It's a really beautiful thing, and for me, as somebody who has a somewhat of an interest in the visual arts, you know, as in I do occasionally like that. But I got so excited and I showed Myra, I was like, look, Colin's actually showing us how to mix colors. And and she got excited about seeing, I was sharing it with friends who are visual artists, and they were knocked out by it. And that really inspired me to speak up about, because what is so precious about one's process? There isn't really, you know, because at the end of the day, I could tell you everything about how I write a song, but you're not going to write the song I write, and I'm not going to write the song you write. So we are, you know, it's down to, in a way, the personal filter of who you are that makes it, you know, that makes it what it is. You know, does it, you know.
I'm thrilled to hear you say that, Glen. You know, I suppose the trigger for making those little films was basically that at the start of lockdown, a lot of people sent me texts on Instagram and said, look, what colours do you use? How do you mix? I haven't painted since I was a kid. What's the best? And it's, instead of getting back to everyone or running the risk of not getting back to them all, I thought, look, I'll just start to do this. Yeah. And it seemed, I suppose I was worried at the start that it was a simplistic thing. And it was laughably simplistic. And also as well, Glen, and I genuinely mean this, and you know I mean this, because we talk about this a lot.
Yeah.
I still feel I'm at the start. I'm learning. I have so much more to learn. And I was a little bit reluctant at the start to do it, because I sort of thought all these other painters who I admire and love are going to come in and say about how ridiculous it is what I'm doing, because it's completely wrong. But I just went ahead with it, and it's been fun, and people have found it helpful, and it connects, and it you know, it's like working. It's funny, I mean, it's why I love oil paint, and it goes right back to what we were talking about, working with the land and working with the ground. You know, oil paint is linseed oil, one of the purest things, mixed with pigment which has been ground, and that's all it is. And so whenever I'm working with oil paint, I feel even the three-dimensional quality of it is a little bit like tilling the ground. Yeah. Even whenever I made the Seamus Heaney portrait back in 2013, and again, I've talked to you about this as well, you know, there was an element in making that I was making something. I mean, I could never make an equivalent for one of his poems, but I felt I was getting inside and making something that could approximate a hint at one of his digging poems, where his face became the landscape, and his, you know, as I was using the palette knife, I was like digging turf,
yeah,
and sculpting turf, and the painting actually bears all the marks of that, and you can see it when you look at the painting. It's one of the most three-dimensional portrait paintings that I've made, but you know, so I appreciate what you said about that, those wee films. I'll maybe do something else. I'll maybe do a studio tour at some stage, and it'll be the most boring thing in the world to me, but if people get something from it, well then I'm more than happy to continue doing it.
Well, I remember the first time I came to your studio. You came down to me. I remember I was just off a plane. Back from America, and you came down to me. It was early in the afternoon. It was early in the morning. It was like, well, it was around
2010.
Nine.
It was 2010, Glenn.
Yeah.
And it was, it feels like it was certainly before lunch.
Yeah, it was early, yeah. You'd come down from Belfast. I was just out of bed. We talked for a couple of hours. We didn't really do anything. There was no sitting. You just talked and we hung out. And at the end of it, you did a couple of sketches and you took a couple of photographs. I remember you just kind of just like, and it was like you said to me, I'm just like, I don't want to draw a note until I get to know you. I don't want to draw a line until I get a feel for you. That's how the painting happens. And I remember I remember being really surprised when you left. I really liked you. And you gave me a couple of your catalogues with the Belfast paintings, Belfast City paintings and the window reflective paintings, and which were amazing. And of course, I knew the Duke Special painting, which I was in love with. Just had such incredible sculpture about it, you know. But then I remember a couple of months later, I went up to Belfast to visit you because you said it's ready to see. And I remember going to your house and such a beautiful, just a shed out in the back garden. You brought me out, we had a cup of tea, and I went up the stairs and just, I was immediately hit with the smell of linseed oil. You know that, if anyone's ever been to a painter's atelier, what would you call it? Studio?
Atelier is fine, yeah.
Yeah, it's the most incredible smell. And for me, it has a very particular resonance because I remember when I was a busker, when I was 15, I met a young man who was drawing on the street. He was doing street drawings with chalk. And yeah. They were very elaborate, very, very beautiful. And he was doing this beautiful drawing of grapefruits. And, you know, as the magic when you're a kid, I met this guy. We ended up on the 67 and we were heading out to Selbridge back to his house. And I ended up living in his house with his mother for the next 3 years. And his mother, Philippa Garner, she was Philippa Garner at the time. She's Philippa Bayless now. I learned everything about being an artist from that woman because she lived and breathed painting. And so for me, when I walked into your studio, I got the smell of that house that I had, was really part of my formation as a person, that house, because this was the first time I had gone to someone's house where they had art books and they had poetry and they had literature. Like I grew up in a house with, you know, my mother read Catherine Cookson. You know, as Pete Townsend very well said, art in around my way, art was short for Arthur. You know, that you know, this idea of, and I remember so vividly, Colin, the most amazing meals, no television, just records like Miria Callas and Haydn and, you know, just Bach and amazing music. And me as a young kid from Ballymun, from suburban Dublin, to be in this house filled with notions and thoughts and, you know, academia, but no snobbery. No academic snobbery. Was a huge gift to me. And I remember Philippa would occasionally say, we need to do an exhibition. She would have built up all these paintings downstairs, and she painted me, and she painted other friends, and she painted the garden mostly landscape. And we would go into Kennedy's gallery in Harcourt Street, and we would, you know, us young lads would all hang the paintings.
Yeah.
And Philippa would be glasses of wine handed out, and there'd be people gathering, and, you know, Louis Le Broquet would come, or, you know, people that she had met in the art world through the years, you know. And she would sell all the paintings, or most of them anyway.
Yeah.
Oftentimes all of them. And we'd go back to the house, and she'd buy a new car. There'd be food in the presses. There'd be things. We'd be given the job of painting walls, and the house would become renewed. You know, the house would be prosperous again for a while. And then, you know, of course, over time, the money would run out. And this for me was the absolute lesson in the creative life, because I realized that all you need to do, and I was a street musician, so all I knew was that I needed to go out in the street and play some songs, and then get some money, and then I could live well, and then I could, you know, go, you know, then I could, you know, I could live my life. So going into your studio, sorry, I've taken a long way around to the point. Going into your studio was a remarkable experience for me, an experience of going back in time to my formative years. And the thing was, the painting was quite intense for me. Like, I didn't like it. Like, I didn't not like it. But I was like, whoa, do I look like that? Like, you caught a version of me that was like, I had never seen that person. You know, you caught me at a time in my life when I had gone through, like, you actually caught something in the emotions of where I was that I was unaware of. And it was quite arresting, your portrait of me. I've grown to absolutely love it, but at the time I had real difficulty with it. And I remember asking you, could I use it as my album cover? And the reason I asked you, could I use it, was because, well, first of all, I found the painting quite real. And I wanted the album to feel real. And even though I didn't feel like the painting was complementary to my, you know, to my version of what I look like, because we all have a version of what we look like and who we are. And I found it so compelling because there was such truth in it. And I used it. I asked you, could I use it? And you were very graceful, and you let me.
I was thrilled.
No, you let me use it for the cover, but I was really knocked out by it because it was very real. And it was a risk for me. I was nervous about that album cover. But the idea that I was, that you would, you know, can you speak a little bit about the, do you know the origins of portraiture? Do you know much about that? I just love to, because to have my portrait done for me as a Dublin, you know, young Dublin man was a powerful, powerful thing, and I was very really blown away by the fact that you made my portrait. But I'd love you to talk about portraiture as the history of it.
Well, I mean, I suppose I've got to look at it in the context of my own practice at painting heads. Portraiture classically obviously predates photography, and it was afforded only to those people who could afford it. And therefore it was the aristocrats, the wealthy. And so whenever you go to the galleries throughout Europe and the world and look at the history of portraiture, you're looking basically at people who could afford to get the portrait made. I suppose what I wanted to do was to turn that on its head, and to actually paint people who I believed deserved to get their portrait painted.
Yeah.
But I suppose this sounds as if I'm using the subject in some way, but the most important thing for me is actually making a painting, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And the image that I'm looking at, the head, the person in front of me, the person whose drawing I've just made, they are my way in to make the painting. So that's the way around it is. That's the order. what gets me into the studio is that I want to make a painting. And my limitation that I put on myself is the subject. And that's why they end up being as much about the physical craft as they are about the person. And hopefully something of that comes through in the work itself. Yeah. I people often ask me, Glenn, you know, why are the eyes treated that way? And why is the flesh treated differently? Or why do you paint different parts of the face in a different way? I suppose I just instinctively paint people as I engage with them. Mm-hmm. Whenever we are talking, whenever we're speaking, whenever we're engaging, I mean, whenever I see you again, Glenn, I'm not going to recognize you by the tip of your ear. I'm not going to recognize you by whether this curl is in the right place or not.
Or still there.
It's still there. I'm going to recognize you through your eyes.
Yeah.
So I wanted people, whenever they looked at the painting of you and indeed all the other people who I've painted, I wanted people to feel that they were having the opportunity to witness that person as they are on their own. Because in the painting of you, Glenn, you're aware of nobody else in the room. You're gazing off into the distance past everybody else. Mm-hmm. You're on your own. And all of my other paintings most of my paintings have been that way. And I kind of wanted this weird thing of we were able to feel that we were engaging with the person, although they were unaware of us being in the same room. And so that's kind of turned portraiture on its head. And the other thing as well I did with a silent testimony exhibition, which is a body of work I did in 2015, Glenn.
I love this body of work.
Where I made 18 portraits of people who suffered loss through the Troubles. And it's toured and it's become something so much more than I ever thought it would. I wanted to afford that privilege. I wanted to elevate and acknowledge these people's plight and strife.
And give dignity to it, yeah.
Well, yeah, by saying, right, I am going to, because I hadn't painted the Queen at that stage, but I painted a lot of others. Yeah. And I wanted to say, look, this is as if not more important a person.
Yeah.
I'm sorry,
this sounds like a funny question, but do you think that, because you did a beautiful portrait of the Queen, and I wonder, could you have done Silent Testimony after your portrait of the Queen? Would it have worked? Because I think it really made sense in terms of the history of you as an artist.
Well, it would have been a completely different painting, Glenn.
Yeah.
I think there was an empathy and an understanding, understanding of the conflict in which I grew up.
Yeah.
You know, I grew up in Southwest Belfast.
Yeah.
And, when you're in the middle of it all, it's just a mess. And, I gained an understanding of it, which changed me, I think. And so whenever I made the painting of the Queen, the sequencing was important as well. Yeah. She had spoken in Dublin Castle, and I think it was felt that it was the right time to make an Irish painting of the Queen. And I very much see that, and actually I said it to her. I said, "Ma'am, this is going to be an Irish painting of you." And and in some ways that was a seismic thing.
Yeah.
You know, to have an Irish painting of the Commander in Chief of the British Army.
Yeah.
You know, it's.
I love the fact that you were mistaken for Martin McGuinness. Can you tell that story?
Oh, yeah. For those way back.
Yeah.
This was whenever I was in art school in Belfast, and my hair was really long in those days.
Yeah.
And Martin McGuinness would have had exactly the same shape head.
Yeah.
And the hair was out the same as mine.
Yeah.
And I used to walk down York Street in Belfast, which wasn't always the safest place to walk down.
Yeah, yeah.
And people would be shouting Marty at me. And,
that must have been so strange, Colin.
Well, it wasn't the best look to sport in 1980. Wow. You know what I mean? Yeah. You know, so it was just funny. No, but actually, yeah.
But anyway,
you reminded me of the next one, actually, which is whenever I was showing Martin McGuinness and the Queen shook hands in 2012.
Huge.
Which was huge. And that was the way into me making the painting.
Yeah.
And Sky News were broadcasting it live, not the handshake, because that took place in private, but they were broadcasting live the bit after that, which was the first time everybody had to could see McGuinness and the Queen and the President of Ireland together.
Yeah.
And I was tasked with showing the delegation around my work, which was a privilege. And so as I saw this afterwards on Sky News, because I'd recorded it on Sky, and the commentator on Sky, as I was standing there waiting for the Queen to come towards me, he said, "And this is the moment we've all been waiting for. This is the Queen going and meeting Martin McGuinness." And it all came back. I still haven't lost the look. Even the Sky News guy thought I was smart.
I love that. I think that's so great.
Funny. It was funny.
Colin, I don't know how it's happened, but it's 7 minutes to go. I don't know what happened.
Do you want to sing a song?
Well, I sang one at the beginning.
What do you want to do?
What?
Tell you what. Why don't we... our conversations nearly always end up with me making a drawing of some sort.
Oh, brilliant, man. I just called you Martin.
This is about to be cut short.
I put this six minutes to go. In your honor.
I love it.
The cup of tea. Oh,
that's right.
What a lovely conversation. You're gonna draw something.
Can I? Do you mind?
I'd love that. So should I?
What I'll do?
I'll sing something, and you draw something. And
I have never drawn for anyone. I never let anybody watch me draw. I hardly ever demonstrate painting. So this is a first for me here. Okay.
Okay.
What I'll do is I need to do a wee bit of shifting around here, because obviously if I point my phone camera at my sketchbook, I then can't see you. So what I'll do is I'll set the screen up on my iPad here, Glenn.
Okay.
Just so that you can see what I'm doing, or so that I can see you. Right, there we are. Great. So just so as you can see what I'm doing here, there's my iPad.
All right, there's me.
On
yeah,
it.
Right.
Okay.
So look, we've got 5 minutes. Do you think we can do? You can do a drawing in 5 minutes.
Let's do it. I might even be able to do more than one drawing.
Oh my god! So we're gonna get to watch it. Okay, so I'll sing a song and you go for it. Yeah, I'll try not to look.
So you gotta. This is the quickest, it's basically taking a line for a walk here, Glenn. Okay.
Okay.
So you're gonna need to. I mean, you don't need to sit still. But
okay,
certainly
I'll sing.
Have your yeah, okay, go.
Okay. I'll try to stay fairly still though.
Yeah.
And of all the money that e'er I spent, I spent it in good company. And of all the harm that e'er I've done, Alas, it was to none but me. And for all I've done, for want of wit, to memory now I can't recall. So raise to me the parting glass. Good night and joy be with you all.
Let's do one more, Glen.
Yeah, let's keep going. And to all the comrades that e'er I had, who might be sorry for my going away, and to all the sweethearts that e'er I've loved, who would bid me one more day to stay. And since it falls unto my lot that I should rise and you should not, I will gently rise and softly call, good night and joy be with you all. And if I have money enough to spare, and leisure time to sit a while, there is a girl in this fair land who surely has my heart beguiled. With her long brown hair and ruby lips, she surely has my heart enthralled. So raise to me a parting glass. Good night and joy be with you all. Oh, wow.
There we go. Now, that's one.
Beautiful, Colin.
That's the other. Now, that's very typical, Glen.
That's what you would start with, generally.
That's very typical of the sort of work, the sort of drawings I would make whenever somebody is in the room. Yeah. And, you know, so I'm looking at how the face works. I don't want them to sit still.
Yeah.
And it's sort of, I'm not making an exact representation of the ear, but I will remember what I see whenever I look at the drawing, if that makes sense, Glen.
It's wonderful. That's
beautiful.
Like
that was beautiful. Oh, thank you for doing that, Glen.
The Parting Glass, what a song. And so that's how you, that's your shorthand. You know what you that information is particular to you.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, I will remember, if I can start the painting reasonably quickly afterwards, I will remember what I saw whenever I made those marks. So, it's often try and get a likeness a little bit more than what I got there, but it's the first time I've ever used Instagram in order to draw you or anybody else.
Yeah.
So it's a first for me. I might be tempted to make a painting that way sometime, Glen. So if I lift the phone to you and say,
brilliant,
Glen.
Brilliant.
You're
saying you wanted to do a painting of me with the horns at some point.
I flip. That's for whenever we meet. That's for whenever we meet again. But you could wear the horns next time, Glen. I thought those horns were fantastic. I love
them. They're great. The Footsparn, the beautiful Freddie from Footsparn is a great mask maker. She made it from. But listen, we're going to get cut off in.
Yep, we are.
Very soon. Yeah. We've got a minute for Grant. Martin, what the hell is going on? Colin, sorry.
What is going on?
Sorry. Wow. Because it's funny because I really see it too. The Martin but like we'll stop now. Sorry, Colin. It's the in vino veritas. I've loved
it's been great to
you.
Chat
Thank
to you
Glen. So much.
Yeah.
I really, really enjoyed this.
And thanks for everybody else for tuning in as well. It's
thank you everybody.
Great, Yeah, Martin, really wonderful. You see that? Someone else's. I suspect.